Greatest battlefield implement ever devised, George S. Patton on the M1 Garand. Hey dudes, this is part two of the Nutnfancy tabletop review on the Garand rifle. Thanks for coming back. Finished up in part one, talking about ergonomics. We pick it up now in materials and quality, most of which I think I've covered under innovation and design. I want to stress once again that this is a steel and wood combat rifle, a rarity these days. A rifle with soul, as my friend Bugganuster says. It has soul. It has meaning when you pick it up. It connects to us individually. I don't want this to sound corny or anything, but it's true. I think that's another reason so many generations have fallen in love with the M1 Garand. I think the primary reason for that is just his phenomenal service record, how hard-hitting it was, how lethal it was at extended ranges. Yeah, you fall in love with something that saves your life on the battlefield. But beyond that, we're talking about construction. We're talking about the materials, the quality, the black walnut stock, the forged receiver, the high-quality barrels, all that attention to the detail, at least in most M1 Garands, which connects to us as users. Throughout its history, the M1 Garand did have problems with quality control. For instance, this is anecdotal, doesn't mean much, but it kind of gives some insight into how perhaps difficult it was putting together an M1 Garand that was tight, serviceable. After World War II, the Korean War kicks off, they find out their existing stocks M1 Garands, which had been put into storage, I think, were not sufficient, so they need to crank the production line back up. That's when HRA got into the game, and they had produced some other military contracts. They were very capable. I'm talking Harrington and Richardson. 1953 to 1956, and that's where this gun comes from, produced M1 Garand in extremely high-quality fashion. Another one came along for the ride, given contract, International Harvester. And it, I didn't want to say attempted, it produced rifles from 53 to 56, but it had problems throughout its production run, is what I was told. Particularly in that they really hadn't put together a battle rifle before, or any rifle, and so Springfield Armory attempted to help them. They actually produced parts for IH, and I think there are some interesting parts matches with IH rifles that will indicate that. You'll see on particular receivers, the spacing of the letters will indicate that it's actually a Springfield-supplied receiver. Again, I don't want to get bogged down in those actually fascinating details. But IH had some problems. They couldn't do it, and particularly they just, for whatever reason, couldn't seem to put together a correct M1 barrel. Actually asking Marlin, the gun company, to produce them for them, and they produced them on the contract. The first batches were not so great quality. I think they were called the blued Marlin barrels because they were actually blued and not parkerized. And then later on, Marlin got their act together, providing very good barrels to International Harvester, and those came too. I think those are Marlin marked. Again, details might be wrong. You can look them up in the books and find them. And those guns are actually quite collectible. Just because I'm talking International Harvester, because they're fewer in number. Probably just as good as shooters. I don't know. I haven't shot any of them. But I think most guys that get IH Garands are just collecting them. They will be wall hangers for the most part. And while we're at this front portion of the gun, back in the 30s, the gas tube portion, which you see here, of the M1 Garand was actually quite innovative in that it was made of stainless steel, still is, and they didn't really have a process to blacken the stainless steel. I think they did all kinds of processes from painting to, I don't know, putting carbon on it or something like that, and in wartime, I'm talking this portion right here, it would actually wear off and become bright stainless again. And so soldiers would actually blacken it with soot, whatever they could, keep it blackened. And some of the World War II photographs, if you see an M1 Garand going along for the ride with a marching soldier, and you see the gas tube bright, you'll know why, because they didn't have a technology back then like we do now to blacken stainless steel, kind of innovative, but stainless steel. And there are product improvements throughout the life cycle, I think I mentioned this already, to the M1 Garand, one of which was, you can't see it here, obviously, because it's internal. The gas port was chromed after World War II. So if someone's trying to sell you a World War II M1 Garand and you somehow get to looking at it, you take it apart and you see there's a chromed gas port, you know it's not a World War II barrel post-war. But it's a product improvement. Once again, going back to what I said in part one, is I kind of prefer the 1950s Arrows rifles because they incorporate all the improvements of the line. That's because for my philosophy of use, collectability is probably 40% of the equation and shootability is about 60% of the equation. I still want it to be a viable combat rifle. That's just me. Materials and quality, phenomenal, old school, the way things used to be, just gorgeous. Let me say this, by the way. This is a new production CMP special rifle. That's what CMP calls it. And this actually has a new manufacture barrel on it. This barrel was not manufactured in World War II, wasn't manufactured in the 90s, it was manufactured in the 2000s by a subdivision of Krieger barrel, however you say it, and it's called a Criterion barrel. And I will tell you from my own experience, they are outstanding. Great shooters. Again, going back to philosophy of use, what do you want out of your Garand? I want minimal throat erosion. I want minimal muzzle wear. I want it to shoot well. You might want to consider getting a CMP special. For the money, I think it's going to be probably the most cost-effective option you can find, unless you decide to put the gun together yourself. I think putting an M1 Garand or an M14 together from scratch, for that matter, with headspace issues and stuff, a little bit more complex than you'd think, unless you have access to someone who can gunsmith them for you. The Criterion barrel on the CMP special, highly recommended, and also has a new production, black walnut CMP with a cartouche stock. Voila! Materials and quality. What else? Oh, firepower! This will be fun! 8 rounds! How's that for an answer? Once again, when it was initially chambered in the prototype stage for the 276 Pedersen, it was a 10-round magazine. That would have been an interesting gun, don't you think? A 10-round M1 Garand. Well, nothing fancy. Maybe someone should make a 10-round 276 or something like that.
Nice.
Maybe. I don't think it would sell that well. In fact, I don't think the 308 ones sell that well. And by the way, 308 CMP recently just came out, subject to change, discontinuance, all that other stuff, with a 308 chambered CMP special Garand. I think that's a great option if you have 308 ammunition on hand already. 30-06, 308, very similar in ballistic performance. 30-06 edges it out a little bit. What would you prefer? I prefer 30-06. If I have to buy the ammunition anyhow, I want the original chambering for the gun. Getting back to, well, maybe they should manufacture a 10-round Garand. I think it would sell, I really do, but I don't think it would have the same attraction to people like you and me. That it's not a gun that served in the wars. It's not a gun that is proven. Half the equation, actually more than half, is the freaking cartridge. The 30-06, this thing hits like a hammer. It blows away every other main battle cartridge today. I wouldn't say it blows away 7.62-51. I'm not saying that. How about the AK round, 7.62-39, 5.56? Yeah, 5.45 Russian? Dude, there's no comparison. It comes at a big expense, though. Namely, rounds count. 8 rounds, and then 1 Garand, and, wait for it, heavy. That's right, basically double the weight of your M4 is what you can count on for 30-06 ammo. How do I know this? How about because I run and gunned, I don't even know if I said that right, with all the ammunition. Here we go. World War II style cartridge belt. This is TMP number 2, Markham. And these things are heavy. It's the same lesson learned by our troops in World War II and the Korean War. 30-06 ammunition to carry, especially with steel and block clips, is heavy. You want to talk heavy, check this. I'm going to jump ahead to accessories, but man, is this a sweet accessory for the Garand. Highly recommended. It's the Olongapo Outfitters 12-clip pouch. This is the name right here. Made in the United States of America out of Cordura nylon. Check this. Wow. This sucker is very heavy. I wrote the weight down somewhere. Where is it? I forget. I'll annotate it. No, I have it here. 6 pounds, 14 ounces is what this weighs. If you were to compare it against AR-15 ammo, I'm talking loaded ammo in an aluminum magazine, it is exactly double the weight. I'm talking this stuff right here. If you get 30 rounds of 30-06 in steel M-block clips, double the weight. So there you go. Limited rounds, it's heavy. You guys know that, but man, does it hit hard. And there weren't many complaints in the battlefield about the firepower of the M1 Garand, at least in World War II, because they were going up mostly, at least until the latter stages, up against bolt-action rifles. And the M1 just absolutely owned them in terms of firepower, the ease and speed of the reload. You heard that the quote I started off part one with. You know, there were positions held simply by the virtue of the M1 Garand and its capabilities to fire and fire a lot. Firepower, therefore, I will term as adequate That might surprise you. It's adequate because it's a 30-out six round, capable out to 400 yards with iron sights with the M250 grain round. There is an inability, at least easily, to top off the M-block clips when they're inside the M1 Garand. There is a technique which you can do that. I didn't try it. The thinking at the time was, hey, if you need to top it off, just fire the rounds through if you have enough rounds. Or, don't forget you have this. I forgot got to cover it. See how I didn't lock it all the way back? There you go. I forgot to cover it in ergonomics. That ejects the M-block clip at any time. You open the bolt, you press that button, doing, out it will come. Don't forget, if you want to reduce the firepower for hunting purposes, maybe match purposes, you do have reduced capacity M-block clips available at Brownells, other places that you can get it. Here's an advantage. We talked about the weight, perhaps the size. I don't want to talk about that. It is bulkier. The weight and the reduced capacity, but a good thing on the spring steel M-block clips is you can keep them loaded forever and you're not compressing a spring. They're ready to go into action. That, in my estimation, is a huge plus. Huge plus. By the way, these M1923 cartridge belts, this one is one from Fulton Armory, by the way. Kind of heavier canvas. It is a reproduction, of course. This one was bought off Amazon.com from a place I forget what it was. I think it was even more than Fulton. Lighter weight canvas, although I love the khaki color better. Reproduction. They are excellent. They work as good as they did back in World War II. They're not LBE, they are old school, but man, great job. That's firepower as I see it. What's next? Reliability and durability. Huh, time for another quote. How about we talk about General MacArthur talking about the M1 Garand's performance in the Pacific Islands. I think the Bataan operation. The M1 Garand performed in an outstanding manner, without malfunction, under combat conditions, as much as 7 days consecutive, without any maintenance attention whatsoever. That's from General MacArthur, who, again, participated in the development of the M1 Garand, and I bet you he was glad his troops had it. Cold conditions, hot conditions, jungle conditions, sand conditions. Didn't test that here in the TMP. I'll tell you what, though, I did test cold conditions, I think, as thoroughly as I could, given the conditions. That operation was called Arctic Ops with M1 Garand, and it performed very, very well, with a couple caveats. What? Make sure your M1 Garand is lubricated. In field strip and maintenance, I'm going to show you exactly where you need to lubricate it. There's all kinds of information out there already that will tell you that. But if you don't grease your M1 Garand in the proper places, you will get failures to go into battery, maybe failures to strip off the last cartridge. If we talk about reliability, I will say we did have stoppages with M1 Garand in the TMP operations. We did. I'd be lying if I said we didn't. And I'll show them to you. I already have in my previously posted videos. I would attribute most of these to a lack of lubrication, because this one in Arctic Ops with Bug It Nuster, I actually just took it out of the box. I made sure it was free and clear of obstructions and I ran it. I wanted to see if it needed lubrication. The answer is yes, it does. I was an M1 Garand newbie too. Learning, nice. I'm learning. Took it back, field stripped it, lubricated it as indicated. Heck, in the US Army's manual, ran 100%. I had no issues whatsoever with this one at all. All the HRAs, HRA, and I'm going off memory, guys. I may be incorrect. We may have had a failure to go into battery between the two, but overall, I think reliability between the two HRAs was phenomenal. Last run and gun with my son, Last Suspect, with this World War II era Springfield Armory M1 Garand 1945. We had several issues of it not stripping off the last cartridge off the M-block clip. Slowly. We're going to take this one apart for field strip, take a look at it. I think it could use some more grease, and it might have a tired op spring. We never replaced it. It just has been what it is, so who knows. So the game plan is replace the operating spring, lubricate it, sooner or later go shoot again, see how it does. See how it does. Is it good? Is it bad? Overall, we'll say the reliability in our running guns, excellent. Excellent, with a few hiccups here and there. How about, more importantly, much more importantly, we talk about its service record once again and really drive it home. Three wars. I think that one quote by General Marshall nailed it best when he says that the troops really couldn't come up with a way to improve the performance of the M1 Garand. Now, these are guys who are fighting with it day by day in the trenches in minus 40 below, maybe even colder conditions, over the beach, in the jungles. Now, granted, he was talking about Korean War operations, but I think most of the generals, like Patton, would say as much. They bet their lives on the M1 Garand and they loved it. Let's go back to my original question. Is it still a viable battlefield option in 2012 and beyond? Absolutely. We talk about ergonomics as something I probably should include it. I didn't. You're going to lose out on some modern day innovations. That is Picatinny rail. It has none. Ability to mount optics easily. Nope, you don't have that. Ability to easily engage targets at night. We did that, by the way, in TMP, just seeing how it was. Very difficult. Imagine that. It's iron sights. Unless you throw some light on them, you're not going to see your iron sights. Difficult. Those are all downsides of basically a 1930s era battle rifle. But that's about the only downsides. Reliability, the hitting power, the excellence of the iron sights, if you can see them through lighting conditions, the durability of the design. Amazing. And I'll tell you what really amazes me, the M1 Garand throughout all the environments that it fought in. Think about it. The jungles of the Pacific, the frigid, snowy conditions it served up in Alaska with a wood stock. In all my research of the M1 Garand, I never read anything where guys were complaining about the wood stock. It just blows my mind that it wasn't warping, changing point of impact. You know, it's a multi-piece design. You have the forward handguard, the rear handguard, the main stock. Didn't it? Functioned. Maybe it's good it does have all that oil in it. Makes it more waterproof, Nutnfancy. Yeah, I'm with it. Reliability and durability. This is going to be a part two. That's it. Let's get on to, this is going to be fun. Accuracy of the M1 Garand. If I can find my targets. Here they are. This is coming in no special order. I've been shooting since December 2011, the M1 Garand. Usually when I went out and shot this sucker, it was raining hard, which made accuracy testing very difficult. And yet this is what I came up with. No, 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 no. That's a 50-yard sight in. CMP Garand, I think that's the special, this one right here, because that's when did most of the accuracy testing. Then I ran the HRA correct and did the rest. Look at that group. Hey, you're only supposed to shoot 150 grain bullets in the M1 Garand, otherwise it can be overgassed and you might bend your operating rod. There's actually some truth to that, but I didn't experience that in limited shooting of this round. 180 grain Federal Premium. I have that box around here somewhere. Here it is. This stuff, it's a good price on it, by the way, check that. That stuff shot awesome out of the M1 Garand. I only shot, like, I don't know, 12 rounds or something. Look at that group. Dudes, that's iron sights. Granted, that's 50 yards. Still impressive to me. This is Lake City 1957 M2 Ball. 50 yards. This is sight in, so I'm adjusting the sights and I take it out to 100. Very, very pleased. Check this. This is the CMP HRA 1955 correct grade, 50 yards, and dudes, the wind was cranking. Look at that group. I know, I'm impressed. Now this was a different range day, so it wasn't raining. This day was a different range, but it was windy. Inch group at 100 yards, so 2 MOA at 100, I'm sorry, 50 yards, 2 MOA at 100, maybe. Very impressed with that. Same gun, still windy, 1957 M2 Lake City. There you go, 50 yards. By the way, this is a great target for shooting your M1 Garand because against those iron sights, you got contrast. I found it very difficult, by the way, shooting steel out in our running guns here in TMP with the M1 Garand, because sometimes that steel front sight, I hadn't coated it with fluorescent paint or anything, blended, and it was difficult to see, especially in low contrast lighting. Against this target, it did great. 100 yards. Same ammo. Same day, same gun. Harrington and Richardson, 1955, correct grade CMP rifle. With Ball, another 100-yard group. opened it up a bit on this one. Still a phenomenal four round, or maybe five round group. Very, very pleased with that. Out of the HRA correct grade. And if you've forgotten, it's that rifle behind me. It looks just like this one. They all look the same kind of, right? Okay, this is back to the first time I went out. The rainy day, you can tell because the target's all warped from just getting soaked. 100 yards, same ammo against a torso target. There's your results, guys. With careful shooting, quality ball M2 ammo, I think this is what you can expect to get, this group especially. About 2 to 3 inches. That's a good group. I was very pleased with that for wind and rain. Then I shot some 150 grain soft point premium ammo. This is at 100, snowing. This is in February 2012. About a 3.5 inch group. You can see the three shots right there. CMP special again, February 2012. Greek M2 HXP, 100 yards. That's a sweet group. How about this one right here? Nice. I think that's a three shot group too. I'm just showing you. I mean, if it sucks, I'll show you. This is what I got action testing. Actually, a couple days ago, I'm like, I'm getting ready to do the tabletop. I need to take that out again and do some more accuracy with it, maybe different ammo. And I started going through my targets. I'm like, I don't see how I can do better than this. How do I improve on this? Why spend more money on ammo? The results are right in front of the camera right now. Here, I'm gonna end with this one. This is in January 2012 in the rain and snow. Wind. Lake City M2 ball. This is my point of aim. This is, I think, before I sight correct a little bit. I had a left to right crosswind, non-adjusted. Look at that group. Wow. I'm not gonna say the M1 Garand is a one MOA rifle. It's actually, it probably could be with hand loads and careful shooting. I think it actually could be. I don't hear many complaints about the final version of the national match rifles that the competitors used. I'm talking M1, true national match rifles. Those guys loved it. By the way, there's a stamping on this barrel right there. That's kind of cool. I think the M1 Garand is very accurate for what it is. I'll call it a easily two to three MOA accurate gun with iron sights. But Nutnfancy, you're a proponent of optics. I am. I love optics. But I learned to shoot irons as a little baby boy under my dad's tutelage, and that skill has carried with me throughout my life. Got an alley here on the ammo. And I recommend you do too, because it could serve you if you decide to integrate and use the M1 Garand as your primary battle rifle. Let's, again, reemphasize just how awesome the sights are on the M1 Garand, especially if you pair it with a .062 width national match front sight. Accuracy, outstanding. Field strip. I don't know if I should spend time on this. What do you guys want? There's so many places where you can find field strip. I think I will do this. Oh, gee, should I do it? Wrangling these 10-pound guns is just, it's a headache. The gun I'm going to use is a 1945 Springfield. Don't take your M1 Garand apart all the time. I don't recommend it. If there is a disadvantage to the design, that is every time you close that trigger guard to reassemble your M1 Garand or M1A or M14 if you were to have one of those in the military or wherever, or Mini 14 with a wood stock, you're compressing that wood again. And what you want is this to fit very tightly into the receiver. So every time we take it apart, we wear and we compress that wood more. So this one and his stock that he has, Doodle, it's so compressed already. I'm going to use this one. I wouldn't do it to any others. This, by the way, is a machined trigger guard, which is actually my favorite. Period correct, that is World War II. They went to pure stamped, I think, in the 50s, and so the CMP special here has a stamped trigger guard. You know, whoop-de-doo. On a really tight M1, you might have to get a punch or other tool, maybe wrap an electrical tape to get this trigger guard off. You're basically gonna detach it and swing it like this. And hold on, let me go back, because I know I did this off camera. I might have to do it off camera again. We do our safety check, of course, point in safe direction. And we take out our trigger guard. Voila. You don't have to do much with this at all. You might lightly lubricate it. These are extremely durable, again, harkening back to 1930s machining quality. This is what you'd gunsmith if you want a lighter trigger pull. You could actually send this to an M1 guy that knows it, and he could gunsmith it. And then, piece of cake, the receiver comes out of the stock channel, and there you have it. You've exposed pretty much everything you need to look at to service it. You might look in this one and see how I lubricate it. See the bolt? I have some Shooter's Choice grease there. Anywhere there's shining metal, you need some grease. I keep the follower track lubed, but nothing fancy, it'll get dirt in it. So I'll clean it again. That's what they did in World War II, worked fine. And I think perhaps this gun, the reason it's not stripping that last round off is I don't have enough lubrication right here. This is the op rod, and you can see it will make contact with the bottom of the barrel. It's in its rearmost position right now. I'll throw it forward, maybe I can show you guys. Depress the follower a little bit. See this portion right here? You need some grease on those two pieces. I thought I'd put some, but if you look right there, you'll see it's dry. Maybe Tactical Doodle did this, he didn't know. So job one is get that clean. This is your follower rod. To get this out, it's very easy to detach from the follower. And this one probably is not parts correct for this model. See how it has a different finish on it? Not that that is not present in World War II Garands. It is, because the parts were actually taken out of a bin close to the same date of manufacture, within 1 or 2 months. We're not exactly sure, nor are we the experts on it. Sorry about that. Follower rod, so you just grasp it firmly, detach it, notice the orientation for reconnection, and out comes your operating spring. We're going to replace this one too. They're very inexpensive. Brownell sells them for like $7 or something for a stainless Wolf spring. I don't know if it's stainless, but there are stainless ones available. There you go. So when I get my Garands, I take these op springs out, and I'm going to do it because it's greasy. Clean out that tube and the op handle. Make sure there's no rust in there. Dry it out, then I lubricate it. I recommend a grease like Shooter's Choice or a Teflon white grease, like that. And then you just put it back in, reconnect it. I'm gonna have to put this down a lot better. And then you'll clean the barrel from the muzzle end using a copper solvent. Be careful you don't wear and tear that muzzle as you do it. If it gets really dirty, you can take off your gas plug screw, which, by the way, there's several ways to do it. You can use a combo tool. They make a dedicated tool too, just like so. And I didn't really cover it under innovation design, but there's actually several variations of this gas plug screw that came out during World War II. It had related to grenade firing, the ability to discharge excess gas. They integrated a poppet valve with it in later designs, and that's what yours should have. If you had an early 1940s M1 Garand, you might have an earlier size gas screw. Easily researched, plenty of information out there, but it's easy to take this off. All I'll do is unscrew this gas plug like that, or gas screw plug, and then I can slide off this whole gas unit here, clean inside. Take off the front handguard, clean up there. And that, again, that's not something you need to do too often. If you live in a human environment, I'd be very fastidious in lubricating your gun to prevent rust. And then the rotating bolt will lubricate just like we would anywhere else. I'm talking Mini 14. I always put a little bit of CLP right here in the channels too. You can see I lubricate on the exterior there just a little bit. Get in the chamber with a chamber brush. You can use the original or copy chamber brush for the M1 Garand. It'll do a great job. Clean it. Starts coming out semi-clean. You'll never get all the way clean. Lubricate it. Done. Field strip of the M1 Garand is very simple, and that's another reason the troops loved it so much. I'll call that good. Accessories. I'm going to start with this gun since it's trying to put it together here. Since it's right in front of the camera. How about that M1907 leather sling, Nutnfancy? You like that? This actually is inherited. Came with a gun that Doodle bought a long time ago. This is a marked MRT. I think that's mildew resistant treated. That was marked as such as World War II. I think they're marking it here as kind of a throwback to those style. The M1907 sling is actually more suited to competitive shooting or any kind of shooting where you have a lot of time to set it up. And you can actually use its sling capabilities for stabilizing. Whereas you detach the front portion, size it for your bicep of your off arm, and then you loop it around and you get a lot of stability shooting your M1 Garand that way. It's a great sling. The initial spring, and it's a carryover from the M1903 Springfield, the initial ones had brass class, and then later ones in World War II had steel ones. It's really hard to put a date on which ones are which in my research. It's a great sling for, again, you have a lot of time to shoot. Let me show you some other variations. One I just loaned. This one is from Turner Saddlery. In what some would consider the best M1 Garand quality sling out there. Turner Saddlery, I think it's like $70 or something. It's an M1907 military sling, leather. And these are heavier than those OD slings. I think they weigh 8.5 ounces. And there's another one from Springfield Armory. And it's right here. And look at the quality difference. This one's pretty bush league, if you ask me, from Springfield Armory. I'm not impressed with it. One, it's not treated. It is lighter weight. I think it's lighter weight than that other one. I think it's like 7 ounces, but you'd have to put some neat's foot oil on it or something. There you go. In running guns, though, we preferred this one. Especially off barricade, the 1907 got in the way. You didn't have time to adjust it to yourself anyhow. Whereas if you adjusted this one, the olive drab canvas sling, you would have time to sling it up, at least on your offhand, get some stability. You'll see me in my standing shooting of the M1 Garand do that, and it makes a difference, a lot. Couple sling options. How about the bayonet? No, 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 no. Here comes a repro, that is reproduction of an M1905 16-inch. Yeah, 16-inch bayonet. Mini review. This was ordered off Amazon.com by TMP for the review. And it is cool looking. These were carryovers from, I'm talking World War II, from the M1903 Springfields. They were employed, I'm talking the 1905 bayonet, they were employed in World War II. They were effective. However, a couple things conspired against this particular size of bayonet. One, it was so long that it's 16 inches, it was ungainly for the troops to travel with it attached to the gun in vehicles, from what I've researched. I, myself, if I know I'm going to do a bayonet charge, this would be the one I'd want on top of my rifle. Standoff, baby, what I've said in my knife reviews, right? Totally. Standoff capability. Not exactly light. I think they're all around like 27 ounces. This one has a replica M3 scabbard on it. And it ran, I have it written down somewhere, from Amazon.com. I think around $65 or something, this one. Cool. It's a nice way to set off your M1 Garand. It has a firebomb insignia. Replica. It's not an M1942. That's just a replica date of manufacture stamp, plastic handle. Not sure what exactly kind of steel it is. This one actually comes relatively sharp. Not razor sharp, but relatively sharp. I hate it when bayonets aren't sharp at all. But they don't have to be sharp to be effective. I know, but I still like it sharp. What if I'm going to use it, which is 1,000 times more likely, as a utility knife? Here comes the M1 bayonet. And this was a result of their lessons learned with that too long 16-inch version. This was 10-inch, meant for the Garand. And it was called M1, not because it was to be paired only with the M1 Garand, but that was the M-series way of nomenclature that the Department of Defense had come up with at the time. Since it was the first in the series, since they came up with that nomenclature, it was the M1, blah, 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 $65, has a replica M7 plastic scabbard. Initially, I think, had metal scabbards in World War II. They found that they didn't last so awesome. Plastic handle. The quality on this, I will say, is pretty decent. 8 out of 10, especially for the price, around $65, no doubt offshore produced, probably in China, somewhere, box around here somewhere. Fits this very well. I'm talking M1 Garand. In fact, I haven't done it for a while. Let's put it on. There we go. It's on Doodle's M1 Garand from 1945. Sick! Hey, Nutnfancy, would you run around with a bayonet on your gun? Nope. I have zero uses for a bayonet other than just looks. Again, getting back to that philosophy of use, if it's going to be on your wall, put it on there. Looks cool, right? Other accessories for your M1 Garand. How about this? Maintenance kit. Good luck finding an original one that's complete. This one's Brownells. There's your stock number. They are heavy. I didn't weigh it, but I'd say probably around 7-8 ounces. Has a take-apart segmented steel cleaning rod, a combo tool, which also you can take off your gas plug screw with, high-quality cleaning brush, oil container, grease container, just like a WW2, and it fits in that recess in your butt plate with the M1 Garand right there. There you go, M1 cleaning kit. If you have a lot of M1s and you plan on spending some time with the M1, you might want to get one of these, a bore wear indicator. Some guys will do it the poor man's way of just putting a cartridge down the bore, and I'm going to swap guns out at this time. And if it fits in loosely, you know you probably have a lot of wear and tear on your muzzle. You might want to consider valuation. Here comes the HRA Correct version without the sling on it. Let's see what its muzzle wear is. This is a CMP HRA Correct cleaned muzzle. There's no debris in there, so I'm not going to worry about scratching or anything else. So that's registering under 2. Check that out. Oh, that's sweet. CMP actually includes a tag with their M1s mostly, and they'll tell you what the muzzle wear is and sometimes the throat wear on the chamber. I don't have one of those. That's a cool accessory though, if you want to get it. If you're going to be trading, selling CMP or whatever M1 Garands, which some of these are going to be sold to make room for something else sooner or later. No other accessories. Talked about the cartridge belt. Highly, highly recommended. Still a very viable way to carry the M-Block kit clips for the M1 Garand. This one again from Amazon.com. Fulton sells theirs. I'm talking Fulton Armory. I think for around, I don't know, I forget, $30 or something. Very good. I showed you that other carry case at Brownells. And by the way, Brownells call number on this one is, and it's around $46, $47. But the catalog number is 100-004-229 Whiskey Bravo. There is a scope mount out there for the M1 Garand, and it's a scout mount that I found made by a company called Omega. About $170. And it's going to add some weight, it's going to add some bulk. You're going to need a forward mounted optic, either a red dot holographic sight, maybe a pistol scope would work great. It has in my other systems that I've run. Check it out. Oh, and I don't have a on the table, but I'm going to roll in a picture. If you buy yours from CMP, I'm talking your M1, get one of their blue nylon M1 Garand carry cases. They are gorgeous, and I think they're around $26, worth every penny. You can find the 45-inch canvas cases. Fulton sells them currently, $20. Available from other places. I usually like buying from a very reputable M1 place that has a reputation for quality stuff. Fulton's that way. You can get your M3 combination tool. If your gun didn't come with one, that's the old World War II style combination tool. Has all kinds of capabilities. And then, if you do decide to reload, you want to shoot some heavier stuff, you want to use some different powders with it, you might want to upgrade your gas plug. Schuster makes one, and then McCann has an adjusting gas plug at Brownells. It's catalog number 100-000-402 Whiskey Bravo. I probably forgot some stuff. Kind of like this. Recoil spring for your M1 Garand. This is what I was talking about. Wolf. There's it. It's from Brownells right there. You can buy it direct from Wolf too. So if you're having reliability problems, might want to upgrade. Here we go, value. Coming to the end. Part 2, Nutnfancy M1 Garand review. All right. This is a snapshot in time. This is what you can expect to pay for a CMP rifle or perhaps an equivalent quality M1 Garand. Rat grade, about $600. There were some Winchester ones available last time I looked on the CMP website. Field grade, about $525. There were some Springfield Armory rifles and some HRA field grade rifles. I'm starting with the lowest quality if you're not familiar, going on up to the highest quality. And then we get to what I think is probably the best all around deal that CMP offers, and that is a service grade M1 Garand. Let me again show you in detail what this service grade M1 Garand looked like. This is HRA, like we've talked about, service grade M1 Garand. Will they all be this clean? No, not really. And incidentally, this service grade HRA came with a lot less cosmoline than the correct grade did. This was not completely coated like the other one was. That rub mark right there came with the gun. I'm talking on the stock. There's a defense acceptance cartouche, the Eagle. Love that. That's one thing I love about the 1950s era Garands. Sling didn't come with it. Actually, it did come with a sling. I'm mistaken on that. I forget if that's a CMP sling or not. And where did that bore indicator? I'm going to burn a little air time with this because I think you guys would be interested. Let's see where this is a service grade. This is a muzzle wear indicator. Let's see where we're at. We are at, wow, 1.5. 1.5? That's like better than the correct grade if I remember right. Coats, there you go. $625 currently, subject to change. After this video, it'll probably go up more as more people order it. Clean, beautiful new production black walnut stock. Reparkerized completely. Not necessarily parts correct. CMP tells you this. This is a Springfield Armory receiver. You can see the serial number right there. New Criterion barrel. That's a huge plus to get this rifle if you want a shooter. It is a gorgeous M1. Probably my overall favorite is the Special. But like I said, 60% shooting, 40% collectability is what I'm after for my M1 Garands. Your mileage may vary. There you go. Like I said, at the beginning and the outset of the video, there's other great places to get an M1 Garand. For instance, there's a website called The Garand Guy. He puts together new Garands, or different Garands. They're all high quality from what I understand. I think his prices are reasonable. You might look into that if you don't want to get a CMP rifle. There's some other places as well. I think Fulton puts one together. They are very expensive there, actually. Very expensive. I would probably go over, get those. CMP also lists some very rare ones. There's some M1Cs, M1Ds, sniper versions for 3,000, 1,500 service grade, respectively. SA receivers. These are all subject to change. Again, this is available in a 308 battle rifle. I'm going to wrap it up. Track record. Battlefield Warrior. Battlefield Warrior. In the extensive run and gunning, which you have been watching here in the Nutnfancy Project, you probably can gather that we are fans of the M1 Garand. To answer the question, is it a viable combat rifle of a major caliber? The answer is absolutely yes. If I went into any kind of conflict with an M1 Garand, I would not feel underarmed at all. Can you imagine being the Wehrmacht going up against an American unit with K-98s, and you know you're going up against M1 Garands with a unit that has a good battlefield reputation and experience? Would you want to be on the other side of an M1 Garand and the hail of fire? Accurate fire. That first word is very important. Accurate fire for an M1 Garand? I sure as the heck would not. It has amassed and a track record worthy of its reputation. That's what I'll say about this Battlefield Warrior. It is a Battlefield Warrior because it has stormed the beaches in the Pacific with the Marines later in the service, in its service life. Served with distinction in Vietnam, Battle of the Bulge, you name it. It is a proven and beloved battle rifle for a reason. That's because it saved lives and it fought for freedom throughout the world. Love the rifle. This is a Nutnfancy review. Gunning in conditions like this. Good job, man. That was awesome shooting. It's a lot of work, isn't it?
Dude.
Sit on it.
There we go.
That's 170 yards, 10-inch plate, iron sights. Slow trigger, Chris.